If you could all find seats, we're about to start. This is a regular meeting of the Princeton Planning Board. It's Thursday, November 5th, 2015, and the opening statement is as follows. Pursuant to Section 13 of the Open Public Meetings Act, adequate notice of the time and place of this meeting has been given by permanently posting the 2015 agenda resolution of the regularly scheduled meetings of the Princeton Planning Board. Such notice has been placed on the official bulletin board at the Princeton Municipal Complex and is to be maintained throughout the year by transmitting a copy of such schedule to the Princeton Packet, Town Topics, The Times, Trentonian, and Comcast Media. A copy has been filed with the clerk of Princeton on the 9th day of December, 2014. Legal notice on the adoption of said resolution appeared in the December 9, 2014 edition of the Princeton Packet. Would you call the roll, please?
Ms. Burge. Ms. Capozzoli.
Here.
Mr. Cohen. Ms. Kronmiller.
Here.
Mayor Lempert.
Here.
Ms. Spruill.
Here.
Mrs. Trautman.
Here.
Mrs. Ullman. Mrs. Gunning.
Here.
Mr. Quinn.
Here.
Mr. Williamson.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. Now all noticed and perhaps met Dwayne Williamson, who is going to be our new alternate two. Welcome to the board, Mr. Williamson.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
And this is the beginning, I think, of a long evening, so you've picked a good time to start. Okay. And now, if you've looked at the agenda, I'm going to go down and see if I can get some papers from Lee. As you all remember, last meeting, we heard that Marvin Reed was leaving the board on the 1st of November, and it seemed unthinkable, but it's happened. So tonight we'd like to present Marvin with a citation and a plaque from the members of the planning board and thank him again for 27 years of service. Marvin, if I can get you to come forward. This is the resolution of appreciation from the Princeton Planning Board for Marvin R. Reed. Whereas Marvin R. Reed has served the Regional Planning Board of Princeton and the Princeton Planning Board from January 1, 1988 to November 1, 2015. And whereas Marvin R. Reed has been more than just a planning board member during his tenure, he was also Princeton Borough Mayor from 1990 through 2003, demonstrating that he is an extraordinarily dedicated member and providing great insight, leadership, and understanding. And whereas Marvin R. Reed's passion and untiring commitment to the Princeton community and the region has made him a forceful and visionary member of the Princeton Planning Board, and whereas Marvin R. Reed's leadership of the Master Plan Committee has resulted in the adoption of new circulation, historic preservation, housing, conservation, and open space elements, as well as numerous updates to other elements in the Princeton Community Master Plan. And whereas in promoting his commitment to traffic and circulation as it impacts the Princeton community, Marvin R. Reed has graciously served as an active participant on almost every committee, subcommittee, and ad hoc committee, and be it resolved that the Princeton Planning Board wishes to honor Marvin R. Reed's achievements and expresses his appreciation of his unselfish devotion to the Princeton community. And be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be forwarded to Mayor Elizabeth Lempert and the Princeton Council, the Princeton Planning Board, to recognize the service that Marvin R. Reed has provided to the Princeton community. Now, therefore, let it be resolved that the Princeton Planning Board offers its sincerest gratitude to Marvin R. Reed and offers its sincerest thanks to him for his knowledge, contributions, and dedication, and extends our very best in all future endeavors. This 5th day of November, 2015.
Thank you.
It's not easy to come here on a Thursday night and not sit in on the planning board meeting. As you can tell, I was used to doing that, and I got a great deal of pleasure. I'm sure as you see the role of the planning board, you right away think of the big projects that we did, Avalon Bay, Palmer Square, the Arts Council, some of them very controversial. And I'm sure that that's significant and one of the reasons why you want to have your voice heard as a member of the planning board. But I'd also admonish you that it's the little applications that very often count in setting the trends for this town. When you take a half-acre lot that's a little bit oversized for its district and you divide it in two and you make decisions as to how we squeeze one more redevelopment into our tight little town. But I wish you well. I'm glad to see some new younger faces taking the seats. I'm glad to, relinquishing my chair to someone who's young enough to fill it. I'm glad to do that. And I look forward to watching you on TV. And from time to time, you may actually see me in the audience. I'll keep track of you.
I hope so. Enormously heavy packets that you got this time. You had some findings of fact resolutions. The first one was the trustees of Princeton University. This is from September 15th of this year. It was a major site plan with variances. And September 17th. Anybody have any emendations, corrections, additions? Can I hear none? Does someone want to move approval of that?
I'll move it.
Trotman, move approval.
Second.
Okay, it was moved by Ms. Trotman, seconded by Ms. Krumwiller. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. The second one was the DNR Greenway. This is from October 1st of this year. It was amended minor site plan with conditional use. Anybody want to correct something, change something, add something? If not, could someone make a motion? Okay, it's moved by Ms. Krumwiller.
Second.
Second by Ms. Trotman. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Now, the next thing you have in your packet was the 2016 annual calendar. I trust you've all checked this. This is usually something that Ms. Ullman does very well and finds that a date doesn't really fall on the Thursday that we expected it to. So has anybody found anything that they want to change on this? No? If not, can I get someone to move the adoption of the 2016 calendar?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Mr. Quinn, seconded by Ms. Krumwiller. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Right, then we have a couple sets of minutes. The first one was the regular meeting of April 23rd of this year. Anybody find something in that that they like to question or change? You didn't get?
I do. I have April 23rd.
Did you get it? Okay. Didn't get it? Oh dear. Hmm?
Okay.
She didn't get April 23rd. You sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Does anyone have any corrections?
I'll move it.
Okay, moved by Ms. Kumar, is there a second?
Second.
Right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. This subdivision committee meeting, this is only those people who were present at this. This was October 19th of this year. This is myself, Julie, and Ms. Ullman is not here. So, Julie, I guess it's up to you to move that.
I move to approve.
And I'll second it, and we can both...
In favor.
Be in favor of it. Great. Okay, is there any other business before we start the hearings? Anyone? No? Right, that brings us to the first hearing of the evening. This is Partners of White Oak. This is a preliminary and final major subdivision with variances, preliminary and final major site plan, and it's White Oak Lane, Block 2102, Lots 1601, 17, and 18. Our normal practice is to have Mr. Solo walk us through his memo, and then we'll hear from the applicant.
Mr. Solo, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully in this application?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you, and good evening. As the chair indicated, this is a preliminary and final major subdivision and site plan with variances. I'm going to be using drawing sheet 5 of 16, which is the preliminary and final major subdivision that was included in your packets. This is a 21.5-acre site, and let me orient you. I'm going to label my exhibit as PB1. All we've done is added some roads and highlighted the proposed subdivision lines. White Oak Drive is located in the center to the east of the subdivision. Off the map and up at the top to the north would be Ridgeview Road. You can see to the left, Preserve Drive, which comes out, and Great Road would be somewhere here off of the map. Oak Ridge Court and Highland Terrace are part of the Preserve development, which is a series of homes that also surround the property, with Highland Terrace to the north, Oak Ridge Court to the west. The proposed property is vacant. It's heavily wooded. It has slopes ranging from 6 to 12%. Areas of the site have large boulders that are scattered throughout. A wetland area has been identified along the westerly, northwesterly property line running in this general area here. You can see the little hatching that shows up as being wetlands. The applicant is proposing to create four new lots, with new lot 17.01, which is located here, 17.03 and 17.04, all being 4-acre lots. New lot 17.02 will be 9.52 acres, and you can see it is served by a driveway that comes in off of White Oak Drive, but it is also part of the subdivision and part of lot 17.02. Single-family homes will be constructed on each of the lots. No building plans have been submitted at this time. A small detention basin located on lot 1704 in this general area here, sort of the northwest portion of that lot, is proposed. That detention basin will only serve and detain water from the extension of White Oak Drive. There is a proposal to have individual stormwater management for each of the four lots, depending on the amount of impervious coverage that is associated with each of the houses. You'll see in the staff reports we had some concern with that as a procedure. We've met with the applicant. They will address in slightly more detail, but what they are proposing would still be the individual septic tanks, and we do have some concerns in terms of long-term maintenance of those, but that those basins will be located within or under the proposed driveways for each of the dwellings. So we're happy to see that there will be less site disturbance. One of our concerns was the amount of site disturbance and tree removal. And if the board sees fit to approve this, we would suggest that you require as a condition of approval that the stormwater basins for the four single-family homes be located within the driveway or other impervious area. This property is located in the RA zone, which permits single-family homes on a four-acre lot. I'm going to flip over the map. And this is sheet 3 of 16, and we'll label it as PB2. It's a slightly smaller version. It has the same orientation of the other. The reason I'm putting it up is the subdivision showed you where the lot lines would be. What we've done on this map is we have colored in those driveways that I just talked about in gray, and then in brown we show you the proposed conceptual layout for a home. These are by no means exactly where they're going to be, but you can see how the homes would be served. As I indicated, the one lot that has the longer driveway to serve it. The area where the wetlands are will be placed under a conservation easement and will not be developed.
Lee, I'm sorry to jump in, but before you go any further, could you show us where the existing three lot lines are?
Excuse me?
Could you show us what the existing lot lines are?
Sure. I have that. This is sheet 2 of 16 in your packet. And again, same orientation as all the other two. This would be, I guess, PB3. So White Oak Drive currently ends here. There is no cul-de-sac. And there are three lots. Lot 16 to the south, lot 17 in the middle, and then lot 18, which is the larger lot, 9.7 acres, to the back. So technically, they're merging the three lots, and then they're subdividing them back out. But you can see the lots were as existing. Are there any questions? Because I'd like to go back to the other one. Okay, I'm going to talk from sheet 3 of 16 because they show sort of the existing homes. It's a little bit harder to see. You have the cul-de-sac at the end. As I indicated in the beginning, there are variances that are associated with this application, and they are for lot frontage where 150 feet is required, and lot 17.03 has 76.28 feet, and lot 17.04 has 93.06. So there is a variance for the lot frontage of the lots on the little cul-de-sac. It would appear, and the applicant will probably provide some testimony on this, that the variance is a result of trying to keep the cul-de-sac as short as possible rather than extending it to comply. If they were to extend the cul-de-sac to pick up more frontage, there would be more site disturbance, there would be more trees coming down, some of which are fairly large. There are approximately 154 trees of 8-inch caliper or greater which have been identified to be removed. We've asked the applicant to clarify if that includes any of the additional stormwater basins and the proposed houses. The municipal ordinance requires a 1-to-1 tree replacement for all trees to be removed of 8-inch caliper or greater. Within our ordinance, on-site planting is preferred. If that's not feasible, planting can be on either a public land or a monetary contribution to a municipal tree escrow fund. We suggest that the board approves the application, that you make that a requirement, and that they should work with the municipal arborist and land use engineer to finalize those plans. We're probably envisioning some sort of phasing of that 1-for-1 tree replacement when they build the infrastructure to serve the four lots, primarily the cul-de-sac and the detention basin that we had mentioned before. they would then be required to plant or pay for some of those trees, and then again, when the individual homes come in for building permits, we would also go out, survey the trees, and require the one-for-one replacement. There are 12 northern red oaks that are proposed to be planted primarily along the cul-de-sac. In my report, I'm suggesting that the applicant increase the caliper from 2.5 to 3 inches to 3.5 to 4.5 inches. Many of the trees are much larger than that, and we thought giving them a start at a larger size would be more in keeping with the character of the neighborhood. The plans have been submitted. They do show a limit of disturbance and a pre-protection fencing plan. Staff again suggests that if the board approves this application, that it be conditioned that the applicant work with the municipal land use engineer and the arborist to minimize site disturbance with the intent to preserve as many trees as possible. As I indicated, there is a conservation easement along the rear of one of the lots. It would cover about 7.9 acres of lot 17.02. That area covers all the wetlands and riparian areas for that. We've requested that a meets and bounds description also be provided for that. And then secondly, given the environmental sensitivity of this area, we ask that consideration be given to either placing a conservation easement over other portions of the site or a maximum site disturbance impervious coverage requirement for each lot be provided. Our ordinance does provide for a maximum impervious coverage. We've met with the applicant to discuss some of the staff comments the other day, and I believe they're going to share with you a plan which would provide for a 100-foot buffer around most of the perimeter of the site in lieu of additional conservation easements. We think that's a very good start. We did receive comments from two of the board's advisory committees, and I'd like just briefly to summarize those. Those reports are included in your packet. The first is the Shade Tree Commission, which notes that approximately 30 of the trees to be removed are 24-inch caliper or greater, and they again point out the need for a one-to-one replacement as per the ordinance requirements. They have recommended that the applicant consider only 3 lots, as there would be less disturbance and more in keeping with the area. They suggest that the 12 northern red oak be replaced with either white oak or swamp white oak, and that they verify in the field that lightweight construction equipment will be used so that, again, we don't have soil compaction and further impact the tree. You have a copy of the Princeton Environmental Commission's report also. In your packet, they suggested that the board consider denying the frontage variance as the development exceeds the carrying capacity for the site. They suggest that we work to reduce the amount of tree removal, minimize any need for blasting, and that any lighting proposed be for street lighting be LED type. That's a summary of the staff reports. Mr. West, our municipal land use engineer, is here, as is Derek Bridger, our zoning officer, if you have questions for either of them. I don't know if the board has questions of me before we turn it over to the applicant.
Are there any questions?
Let me swear in.
I had a question for Lee. The proposed cul-de-sac, White Oak Lane at this point is a township road, or is it?
Yes.
It is a municipal road. Would the cul-de-sac then be also part of the municipal road system?
That's my understanding, Jack, is it?
But the drainage from that would be
handled by the stormwater basin.
Property under the control.
I think that's more for Mr. West than me.
Okay. Mr. West, maybe I could have you sworn in. You could answer
that.
Yep,
I might get in trouble.
Yes, Mr. West, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
Yes, I do.
Let me swear in Mr. Bridger while we're at it. He may have to go ahead. Derek, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
Yes, I do. Thank you.
Okay, my question was the basin that handles the drainage from a municipal street or something would be something controlled by the Homeowners Association?
It would be maintained by the Homeowners Association.
interesting arrangement for municipal road, but...
I believe we have other situations like that, yes.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Any other questions for anyone?
And then we'll turn it over to the applicant.
All right, thank you very much.
Second.
Yes, Mr. DeGrazia, to the extent that you may lapse into testimony, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
I do. Excuse me. For the record, my name is Christopher DeGrazia from the law firm of Drinker, Biddle, and Reith, here on behalf of the applicant, Partners of White Oak, LLC. Lee did a great job in terms of telling you what the current plan is. But it was a long process to get to this particular place, so I thought I would take a couple minutes to give you a little bit of background. This site has a long history. It was involved with litigation, bankruptcy. The end result is a couple of the neighbors that live either adjacent to or near this property ended up purchasing it through a bankruptcy proceeding. The owners are not typical developers, so you'll see that as I talk about the application and how it was approached. So it's not a typical development application. Their focus was on the enhancement of the neighborhood and on keeping the neighborhood scheme. They live the closest, or at least one of them lives the closest to the site, right off of White Oak on the house right next to it. And they also they have interest in the preserve as well. So they are in the area and part of the community. So the first step was to hire an engineer. Princeton Junction Engineering was hired to put together a development plan for the site. And their instruction was, what could we put, what would be appropriate in the neighborhood, let's meet all of the requirements of the zoning ordinance, and let's not request any variances. So they came up with an as-of-right plan, and I would like to mark that as, what are we at, what, A1? This is a as-of-right plan that does not have any variances. It's in the same orientation as the plan that was shown by Lee Solo. You have White Oak Drive right here. You have the long lot in the back with some of the environmental constraints. And you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 homes under the cluster design. This is an as-of-right plan. There's no variances required. There's no deviations from any of the ordinance. In your cluster design ordinance, you're allowed to cluster and preserve, so the back portion would be preserved. There would be a shared detention, so actually under this design, you would have a lot more disturbance than what you see under the current plan, because this is all, the yellow would be all designed cleared for the detention, and you would have the 6 houses here. I've actually prepared the application. I think we even had some meetings with staff regarding this design, and when we went actually to the applicant said, don't like it. We want to see something different. We want to see less homes, and so Jeff from Princeton Engineering came up with a second design. The A2 design, or the Exhibit A2, is essentially the plan that you see before you today. The only difference is, instead of the cul-de-sac just being at the edge, it goes into the property and is expanded. By bringing it into the property and expanding it,
you now have the 150-foot buffer. This is a non-clustered plan, so instead of the 6 units, you're back to 4 units. You meet the 150 feet on all of the lots. There's frontage down here, so that's how this lot meets the frontage, if anyone was asking. So this is an as-of-right plan, again, meets all of the ordinance requirements. We thought, well, let's shift this down. And you have the current plan.
Use the mic if you're going to be over there testifying.
I'm not used to standing up. I never stand up. So you could see the difference in the cul-de-sacs there. So the current plan, you could see, is shown based on the original exhibit, Lee Solo marked in or shown in the exhibit. So this is the current layout. You're looking at a total of 21 acres, and our original plan and that plans before you preserved something around 8 acres, maybe a little less. We sat down with the neighbors of the preserve, which are the particularly people that own homes around here, and this is the preserve all in this area, and talked to them about their concerns. One of the comments that we took very seriously was that when we look out of our backyards, we see trees, and we would like to keep those trees. So we left that meeting with them that we would put a 50-foot buffer along the property line there to preserve. We, after receiving staff reports, we talked about increasing the buffer, you know, pushing the envelope, where can we go? And as a result, we came up with an additional plan that shows a 100-foot buffer where we could put 100 feet and where we can't. It's either 40 feet in some areas, particularly up here where the lot is a little bit narrow, and 50 feet in this area. And we also, where the other buffer line is right here, you could hardly see it on the plan, we shifted it up, included, I don't know if that's an acre or two, but we essentially shifted it up. So as an end result, you're looking at just below 11 acres, which is more than half of the property, which will have a conservation easement so that the trees won't be disturbed. And then we think it's in the key areas which preserve either habitats or buffer viewscapes and impacts from the neighbors. And that's how we came up with this plan, and that's where we are now. We'll show you that plan, we'll mark it into exhibit, and we'll have our engineer go through it. So I think I'll have our engineer come up, be sworn in, and he can go through some of the testimony. And this is Jeff Brown from Princeton Junction Engineering.
Good evening.
Mr. Brown, to the extent you're providing testimony, which I understand you will, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
I do.
Thank you.
Jeff, can you go over a little bit of your credentials and experience?
Sure. I have a Bachelor's of Civil Engineering from Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. I've been a licensed engineer in New Jersey for close to 40 years. I'm also a licensed planner and licensed land surveyor in New Jersey. I'm the president of Princeton Junction Engineering.
And have you appeared before this board?
I've appeared before this board and many other boards in Mercer County and surrounding counties.
I'd like to present him as an expert in engineering.
Can't we accept your credentials?
Thank you. Hi, Jeff, you've heard Lee and myself give a little bit of introduction as to the current plan and the evolution of the plan, a little bit of the history. I was hoping you could go through the specifics one more time and talk a little bit more about how we're going to plan drainage for each property and anything else you might like to add.
Okay.
Just clarify, is this PB1 or is this A3? I'm not sure whether you are using Lee's original plan.
That's Lee's plan.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we are planning an extension of White Oak Drive with a cul-de-sac. There will be a street light proposed in the cul-de-sac, and sewer and water will be supplied from the cul-de-sac. There'll be a short extension of the existing gravity sewer into the new cul-de-sac in White Oak Drive. First of all, just to go back to the buffers for a minute, this plan, I guess this should be marked also.
That would be A3, and it shows the proposed buffer plan and the enhanced proposed buffer plan.
And what this shows is a 40-foot buffer along the northerly property line, a 100-foot buffer next to the preserve on the westerly side, and also a 100-foot buffer on the southerly side, and then a 50-foot buffer connecting those two pieces near where the proposed detention basin is going. As far as the detention system, what we're proposing to do is on each lot, and this is A2 now that I'm referring to, on each lot, we would propose that the driveways be constructed of porous pavement, and that under the driveway, a stone storage bed for stormwater would be constructed, and that the water from the roof areas and any other improvement areas on the site would be piped into those storage beds, so that each lot would then have its own detention system. And the reason we think that that's the best idea is, if we go back to Exhibit A1, you can see that the area in yellow is, when we did the cluster plan, we based it on a concept of having a single detention basin. And it became quite large because the site actually, White Oak Court is almost at the top of the hill, and the drainage runs off in a bunch of different directions, to the south, to the west, even to the northwest. And it became very difficult to capture the water and get it into a single basin. We ended up having to put in a system of pipes along the westerly boundary of the property, and the basin itself also got quite large because of the slopes. So the area that you see in yellow on this plan is actually an acre and a half cleared area that was required to have a single basin. And even though the improvements on the current plan would be less, the basin would be similar to this because of the slopes involved and the difficulty in capturing the runoff from all of those lots. So we believe that an individual lot system would be a much better plan and result in a lot less disturbance.
I think if we can go back to the the buffer plan, there's something I would like to point out. Sorry, I'm losing my voice somehow, which is a bad thing for a lawyer. So the municipal staff asked us to a buffer in this area was pretty straightforward. We originally didn't have one proposed up in here, and particularly this area, and the municipal staff asked us to take a look at that. This lot, which is 1702, has a pretty tight building envelope because of some of the constraints in the way we are placing the construction of the conservation easement here. So staff asked us, they said, listen, see if you can put at least a 40-foot conservation area right here. The original plans show it being cleared and part of some of the retention system because, like I said, this lot's very, the building envelope is much tighter than the other areas. So we said that that's good. However, we would also need another variance. So in order to bring this and create a conservation easement there, we would have to shift the setback along this line. There's a requirement of a 40-foot setback. We would be asking the board for a 20-foot setback here so that we could shift the building this way a little bit. So it would allow us to create a nice
conservation easement along the neighbor's lot. There's his house up there. He'll have an undisturbed area. We'll have the building envelope, and we will still have about the same size. We would shift the setback instead of 40 feet from the southern property line of lot 1703.
Yes.
Yeah, 1703. And in order to keep the same type of landscape or theme, I should say, where we have 40 feet on both sides, 80 foot, we would increase along this area here the setback from 40 feet to 60 feet. Is that what we show?
Yes.
So essentially, we have another 8-foot separation between the improvements, but we're requesting a variance under C2 to allow us to create this conservation easement. I hope that was clear. And we would extend that along the entire side. So there would essentially be 40-foot easement, conservation area. This area would be conserved. This is the area we added, and we're doing a 100-foot buffer except for this little corner where it comes up into the detention area. Jeff, do you have any other...
I don't, unless the board has any questions.
So let's go through some of the reports maybe and talk about a little bit our response. Oh, one of the other things I wanted to bring up with the board, since we're talking about the conservation area, the main purpose is to basically preserve pristine forest, and that's really what we want to do for these 10, 11 acres. However, these properties will have a huge, you know, dimension. I don't know if this, like, for example, this is 100 feet by 4. What's the dimension going this way on this lot? 450, something like that? This line, the property line?
Yes, it's approximately, well, 450, 132 is the exact.
So, yeah, about 450 feet by 100 feet. And we would like to have some... you know, some things written in the conservation easement to protect that property owner. For example, the ability to post, like, paper signs that says no trespassing or private property, things of that nature. There may be the ability to, or the requirement to go in this area, particularly with some of the drainage facility, depending on how we are able to locate it here. And we talked to the professionals and said, it, you know, in this, you can see there's a square on the plan. That's where the detention will be for the cul-de-sac. So in that particular area in particular, so we may need to carve in, and I know Alan does a great job, but some sort of flexibility with some utilities, particularly drainage. I don't think we'll have other utilities, but we just want to be able to do that. Unlike a developer, and this is really the key, unlike a traditional developer, which has a plan, you know, they can show you architecture, they can show you, here's our, you know, house or Model A or Model B, we don't have that here. This is all going to be customized houses. It's not, we're not, my client's not a developer. He's going to have these houses, so we don't have the benefit of knowing exactly how it's going to lay out, so we have to preserve some sort of flexibility. But at the same time, we're going to preserve half of the property. And the other question that we wanted the ability to remove sick or dead trees and also the ability to plant trees. Most conservation easements have that in there, but I thought that would be good to have in there. And then the other clarification would be whether or not we could put somewhere within it, because like I said, it's 100 feet in most areas, maybe a deer fence that you can't see, something like that. So that's something we would like the board to consider. So those are really the elements under the conservation plan. I think maybe we can move to the reports.
Okay. I'm really just going to go through the ones that we either take exception to or need some clarification.
Good, Mr. Brown, can you keep the...
Hold it closer?
You're losing us. Okay. We're losing you.
Beginning with Lee's report, on page 2, item 4.1, we just wanted to clarify that a little bit to let you know that... of the 154 trees that we're showing as being cleared on the present plan, 16 of those trees are in the cul-de-sac area, and 18 of those trees would be in the detention basin area. The remaining trees that are shown to be removed are really based on the schematic house layout that we've shown, so that may not be a realistic number in terms of what actually gets cleared in the end. We're expecting these, as Christopher said, to be custom homes. They would be sited individually in the field and would hopefully try to avoid as much tree clearing as possible. We did, moving on to page 2, item 4.3, we were proposing to plant the trees at the size that's required by ordinance, which is, I believe, what we have shown on the plan.
What size is that? I know you're proposing 2.5, and
right.
I think Mr. Solak suggested 3.5 to 4.
That's correct.
Right.
4.5.
We would like not to have to increase the size of those trees. We don't think it's a significant increase, and we would propose to just comply with ordinance.
We're all having trouble hearing you. Can you?
You just got to hold it closer.
Real close?
Louder, or hold the microphone up.
Pardon?
Maybe you could actually sit and use one of the stationary mics.
Hello.
So you're proposing the 2.5? Is that what that interchange just was?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things here is that we have done a huge amount of, or had a huge effort to try to preserve trees and put in conservation areas where there's no specific requirements under the ordinance. When you really take a look at this plan, you're looking at cluster. You're looking at a cluster, I couldn't think of the word, a cluster development without the density bonus. And we feel that we've done a huge amount towards the preservation of trees over half of the property. We are planting the trees as required by ordinance, and we don't feel the situation here with so much preserved would require that additional size. Or anything above the ordinance requirement.
Moving to item 4.6 on page 2, discussing the limitations on impervious cover. The ordinance in section 10B 246.1 limits impervious cover on the lots to 14% of the lot area. So there is a limitation actually in the ordinance. And the applicant is proposing the conservation easements, which total 10.97 acres, which are just over 50% of the site.
Wait, I'm just going to interject that. Illegal, is that a...
It's in the
can you use the conservation easement to lower the... I mean, like that? In the calculation?
Yeah, staff question.
We're not.
What's your question?
The question is whether or not the conservation easement lowers the area for impervious coverage.
No, they're correct in the ordinance. It was 14%. That's what's required or permitted by the ordinance.
You're still doing the 14%.
Correct. Yes. We are meeting 100% of the ordinance requirement in terms of impervious, and we're also adding above that in order to protect some of the developable areas, a conservation in those areas that otherwise would be developable.
Okay. My question was, is the 14%, is it 14% of the area that's included with the conservation easement or not?
Yes.
You're saying it is.
And that's normal. I was giving a variety of suggestions of how we might preserve more of the site. The 100-foot buffer is a nice gesture, especially to the adjacent property owners who are concerned about their viewscape. The board can balance it, but I think that the 14% is what the ordinance permits. So it's going to be hard to, unless they voluntarily offer to do more. you know, the conservation easement over the wetlands is required by the state, I believe. So it's really getting the additional buffer that they're showing in gray, the 100-foot to 40-foot, which is much better than what it was before.
Okay, moving to item 4.7 on page 2 of Lee's report. That deals, and I already touched on this, that deals with the issue of the construction of the individual stormwater management basins. And as I described, our opinion is that there'll be much less disturbance by constructing the on-lot basins because they'll be constructed in areas that are going to be cleared from the driveway anyway. So there really would not be any additional clearing for the on-lot basins.
Just to clarify, so the idea is to put detention in areas that would be disturbed. So it may include the driveway or patios or other areas that were cleared to get in the equipment and build the house. So it may overlap the driveway a little bit, but the intent is to keep it under all of the disturbed area for impervious coverage. We're using porous driveway material. Again, it's more of a cost, but we think it's well worth it, and we think it really does save a lot of areas that would otherwise be impacted.
Is that proposed to be by deed restriction?
I think it would be a condition of approval that we'd have to require. I'm trying to think of deed restriction. We don't know where it's going to be at this point.
But the concept.
We could articulate a concept to put it under.
We can certainly. I'm trying to think of how it would play out without knowing where it is. But I guess we could conceptually do something.
But how will you know what the capacity is if you don't know
where the
driveway is?
So ultimately, the way we saw it is that when we come in with a building permit for a particular house, like we're going to do individual lots, so we come in for a lot, we would sit down with the professionals, go over it, show the plans. They have the approvals in place. The approvals require us to put the detention under driveways, patios, wherever we can. And if we don't, that would be a zoning violation. That would be pretty bad. So I think that really does the protection, because at that point, we would know where it is, and we would...
If we can, I was just talking with Jack. I think staff would prefer both, if we could get it as a condition of approval, and then general language in a deed restriction that indicates the intent, which is that the individual storm drainage facilities will be located under either cleared or impervious areas?
To the extent feasible, by your review.
Right, because that way, what happens over time, in 5 or 10 years, a buyer comes in, they may or may not look at the subdivision plan, but you know they're going to look at the deed. And it'll be in there as a reminder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think a deed notice would be good.
And as a condition, each of the lots, as they're developed, will require a site plan approval by staff, as we've done before. So that's correct. That's another review process.
Right. Well, while we're talking about disturbed areas, could we just go over whether these houses will have basements or not, and whether or not there's a problem with boulders in this area and construction?
Yes, we are intending to have basements. There are boulders. There are some areas that have a lot of boulders, but where the houses are situated are in areas where, at least as shown on the plan, are areas that have less boulders. We're not expecting to encounter bedrock. The soils are mapped as Neshaminy. Their anticipated depth of bedrock is 5 to 10 feet. So the issue would be boulders. By carefully positioning the house, we would hope to limit blasting, but you never know when you start digging the hole. If you hit a large boulder, there might be some blasting
required. You would have to have some sort of plan for disposing of these boulders or situating them in other places in the area and so on.
I mean, they are simply a problem for construction on the ridge. There's no getting around it.
Yes, we were involved in building Bouvant Drive and Princeton Ridge, and I know we're well aware that, that boulders can be an issue. I think the individual homeowners, as they go to build their houses, are going to have to deal with those boulders. And I don't know what is the typical thing in town to deal with that situation.
Mm-hmm. Last thing planned.
One of the situations you have here, and one of the concerns that staff had, is if you look at sheet 7 of 16, it shows the grading and it shows the limited disturbance, and that's where the tree count of 154 trees came from. What our concern was this is just a concept. Obviously, that the house that's built there is going to be a custom home, most likely substantially larger than they have shown here. They're going to want to have a pool or other amenities. So we're actually concerned that the disturbance and the loss of trees is actually going to be higher than the 154 once all is said and done. But as far as the rocks, I mean, I think that'll have to be looked at as they come in with each individual house. We've seen people do retaining walls with the boulders, and actually it comes out pretty nice. You can see how steep the grading is on these lots, so I think a lot of that could be softened by boulder retaining walls. But it has to be looked at on a lot-by-lot basis. Yeah, as a condition of approval, obviously any house that's built has to come in with an individual plot plan.
Right. You said something else about putting a deer fence in the conservation area. Is there... there's an established pattern of deer crossing this area that would be disrupted, or you know, deer fences in heavily wooded areas are a little unusual, and they're usually meant to change patterns of migration and so on. Is this something that you and the preserve people have worked out, or?
One of my clients lives here, which is the property right next to the development, and you know he's reported to me that a lot of deer walking down through the area, and I could certainly have him testify as to it. But that's the idea, is that they are in the area.
Well, I'm not
sure. They're in all of Princeton, actually.
Yeah. I'm not sure that makes your area special in a lot of ways, but. I am concerned when you start controlling them on a major basis and keeping them from moving from one place to another, because then you concentrate the herds on properties that when you don't really want to. Yes. Well,
what the board's done in the past, I think if you think of like along Ridgeview and Davies Drive, is usually the deer fences are closer to the house to protect the landscaping that's there, as opposed to all the way out in the woods, because that has been a concern of the board in years past in terms of changing either a migration pattern or if there's a deer trail or whatever and forcing them some other way. But to allow fencing that would protect somebody who's invested a lot of money in landscaping, that's typically what's been done, is just around that the landscaped area.
I think we'll be fine with locating it outside of the area.
Okay. I'm sorry, we can't.
Outside of the conservation area, with particular to the deer fence.
You know, can I ask a question about something you said earlier, that the applicant is not a developer? Does that mean that are you planning on selling the properties to another developer? Is the applicant going to be building the houses and selling them?
All I was saying basically is if they were a typical developer, you would have the clustered plan maximizing density. And they really didn't want to go that way. They wanted to preserve the theme of the neighborhood. And they just had a different philosophy on looking at it. Now, there's certain conditions they need. They need enough area to build so that they can make a big enough house so that it could make it so that they financially could make this happen. They've spent millions through getting the property through the litigation, and they just want to make it so that it enhances the area. So I was just saying it was
okay,
a philosophy.
So they really are going to develop they are going to build the house and sell it. I mean, in some applications we have, people come in for subdivisions and then they sell the lots off.
They could sell, a lot off. The idea, I think, is to sell it off, you know, individually. Find somebody that wants to build a house, they have a custom architect, and, you know, and they engineer it and put it together, talk to them about drainage, and then, you know, like a nice, beautiful, customized house, rather than all the same developer. But, you know, I don't know. Once it's subdivided, it's, you know, it's subdivided. It's individual lots.
Yeah, I mean, this is here for subdivision, and once it's subdivided, it could mean either that the developer or someone, the applicant or someone who buys from the applicant builds the lots, or they're sold off individually. All we know is that this application is just for subdivision, no site plan for the individual lots is proposed at this time.
But we're putting a lot of faith in some of these things about the trees. I mean, just like you were saying, it seems like we have really don't know that it's only this number of trees, right?
Let me say, we're going to impose a condition that requires each lot to have a site plan, and typically that involves the engineering department working with the applicant to minimize tree removal and to maybe minimize blasting or by the location of the house. So I think even if this were a developer doing them all, we'd still have many of those same questions.
And we will also comply with each individual lot with the ordinance that requires every tree one for one. Every tree removed needs to be replanted. If we can't replant it on site, elsewhere where the township wants it or municipality wants it, or in into the fund. So, okay, moving along.
Okay. Moving to page 3, item 5.1i in Lee's report, he suggests the conservation easement, low-impact design elements, and green building certification, all mentions as possibilities in the narrative should be implemented. We have now incorporated the conservation easements that he suggested, and also we do have low-impact design elements in the porous pavement construction, the preservation of the natural features and vegetation, and minimization of clearing and soil compaction. But as has been discussed here tonight, because the current owners, are really not going to be the home builders, that we can't really commit to green building. We support the idea, but it's really going to be up to the individual homeowners and their architects how the houses get constructed. Moving to page 3, item 6.1A. Has to do with the requested variance. I think, as you've heard, the reason for the variance is to shorten the cul-de-sac, to reduce the amount of impervious, and to reduce the disturbance on the lot. We really don't think there's any advantage to providing the frontage by extending that cul-de-sac, and we are requesting a C2 variance for that.
And just for the record, we're also requesting a C2 variance for the setback of that other lot so we could create a larger 40-foot buffer along the property line.
Is our PEC liaison isn't here, correct? Because do you think that they didn't understand that the option to this was the cluster, and that's why they recommended against this variance? Because in the statement it says...
You had the full report attached to your thing. This is part of Lee's thing.
I don't know.
Right. It didn't see.
Yeah, I think they didn't. I'm not speaking for them, but I think that's the exact issue, that they didn't understand what the ordinance allowed. We're having one unit per 5 acre, which is clearly well within the ordinance, and they probably weren't aware of the ordinance cluster option, which would allow 6 units on site without any variances.
Do I understand that Mr. Brown has just provided testimony on the items in the reports where there are objections, and that are the other items or other conditions recommended are acceptable to the applicant?
That is correct. So we're in agreement with all of the other conditions in the report. We're just going through the issues that we felt we should comply with the ordinance requirements, or we need a little clarification, or we have an objection to.
Yeah. I just wanted to go back and I have a question about the cluster ordinance. So when you do a cluster, does the frontage requirement change? Because like the,
yes.
the what was shown, the frontages would they wouldn't qualify.
Yeah, we haven't reviewed their cluster plan in a while. They did share it with us 6 months or more ago. But the way our ordinance allows cluster, the standards get reduced because obviously as the lot size gets smaller, and I don't know what the lot sizes were that they were proposing, so would the lot width, lot frontage, and the setbacks would also change because as you have a smaller lot, you're going to have smaller setbacks and smaller lot width and smaller frontage. But I can't speak to the plan because we haven't reviewed it for tonight's meeting.
But you did review the plan before, and what they showed us was that a conforming cluster that they...
I don't think we did that kind of detailed review to look at it. What we looked at, and we agreed with them, that the four lot is much better than the, what was it, six lot clustered in terms of site disturbance and tree removal. There will be less with the four lot, and that's as far as we went. I can't really speak to, you know, whether the cluster met all the provisions or not. We didn't look at it that closely. We were really looking, as you remember,
well, I mean,
the application we had.
That's pretty important to know, isn't it? Because I always call this, I mean, I don't know a better word for it, but it's kind of like a threat decision where you have one bad, where you say, if you don't approve this, we're going to do something much worse. And so what was much worse is the cluster, but if that's not really an actual possibility, we should know that.
It is a possibility. I can't speak again about the variances. We'd have to look at it. We were looking at it more in terms of tree removal, site disturbance. They could also probably meet the lot frontage. I think they showed us an exhibit where they extend the cul-de-sac a little bit more, and I don't know whether it was 50 feet or 100 feet or more. But again, the balancing I think you may want to consider is whether if you want to deny the lot frontage variance, they can come back with a conforming plan for either four lots and maybe for the eight. Because don't forget, that clearly looked like they could meet it just by extending the cul-de-sac, and all that does is result in more tree removal and site disturbance. So that's really what we were evaluating. They'd have to come back, but I mean, they can. There's no doubt in my mind that they could extend the cul-de-sac to meet the frontage requirements. I'd have to look a lot closer at the cluster to make certain everything was as of right. I just don't know that. But I think we're all comfortable in saying the cul-de-sac could be extended to meet the lot frontage.
If I could just add to that on the cluster, the cluster that we have there, the lots are approximately 1.4 acres. The ordinance actually allows you to go much smaller on the lots than that. But there's a range of lot sizes that are permitted under the cluster ordinance, and that was what we had selected to do the cluster because we felt that it allowed a home size that would be appropriate in the area. So they and to the best of my knowledge, they meet all the frontage and width requirements, which are much different in the cluster provisions than they are in the conventional.
Sorry, does that answer your question? Okay. Do you want to go on, Mr. Brown?
Okay. We move now to the engineering and zoning report, page 3, item 4.0C, dealing with the relation of the structures to the terrain, existing building, roads. We believe that we have met the intent of 10B226. We are providing a conservation easement completely over the environmentally sensitive stream corridor area on proposed lot 17.02. The low-impact design elements, such as the porous pavement for the driveway construction and the protection of natural features and vegetation by minimizing clearing and soil compaction. So our feeling is that we do meet 10B226.
I'm sorry, I'm having a hard time following. I'm not sure what section you're talking about.
Okay, do you want to say the page number again for that last statement?
Basically, yeah, on page 3 of the engineering report, it recites the ordinance requirement that structures are to be related harmoniously to themselves, the terrain, existing buildings, roads, and historically significant features, if any. And it's just we're stating we feel that we've met that requirement. It's an ambiguous requirement. There's no specificity. There's no standards like a setback would have. It's just, you know, so we think that the elements that we've put in place, the additional conservation areas, the protection of the environmentally sensitive areas, I think it's our position we've met fully that requirement.
Okay, on page 3, item 4.0E. Actually, I think that's on page 4. 4.0E. Has to do again with the detention requirements. And as we have stated, we would like to leave that to each individual homeowner, and they would be required, I assume under any resolution that this board would adopt, to comply with the stormwater regulations of the ordinance and the state stormwater management requirements for major development. There was some concern, I think, on the part of the staff that by splitting the lots off separately that they may not then qualify as major development, but we recognize that they're part of this larger project, which is a major development.
Did you want to say something to that, Mr. Grass?
Yeah. What our concern was that the fact that they had the detention base was only for the cul-de-sac, and that each individual lot would do their own stormwater management. So our concern with the original submittal was that it's going to require more clearing of the lots to put stormwater management for each individual lot. So we met with the applicant earlier in the week, and what they're proposing we found to be acceptable is that if the stormwater management for the individual lots is under the driveway or in the proximity of the disturbed area with porous pavement and gravel underneath, that would be acceptable.
I have a question, though, but if you have the septic under the driveway...
It's not a septic.
Okay.
It's stormwater management. The other problem with having it individual lots tying into a regional basin is it actually requires clearing to get the piping to go there. So, it, you know, we felt that it was a good solution to have it underneath the driveways.
Yeah, we're up to the Environmental Commission report. I think a lot of this was touched on probably in Lee's report.
Yes.
Based on my notes, when you look at the Environmental Commission report, page 1, item 1, you already talked about. Page 1, item 2 and 3, you already talked about. So I guess you're up to page 2, geology and hydrology.
Right.
Yeah, I'm just, which report are you on now?
The Environmental Commission.
Okay.
And that, again, raises concern about the boulders and various issues related to soil erosion and flooding. And again, we would be complying with the state stormwater requirements and the township stormwater requirements, which requires reductions in the post-development peak rates of runoff. The project would require Mercer County SCD soil erosion and sediment control plan approval to guard against erosion. So I think we do address the concerns of that paragraph or that section. Moving on to the next paragraph or next section in that vegetation, as we've described, we are proposing to preserve definitively over half the site with conservation easements where the trees would be saved and would be working with the staff to reduce clearing on the remainder of the lots when the houses are sited. And also to try to site the houses in such a way that blasting would be minimized. And then I think the final thing in that relates to noise, which again gets back to the comment on blasting, which we are planning to try to avoid to the extent possible.
Yes, and I'm assuming you won't be crushing the boulders too.
I can't imagine that would be economical to do that here. Particularly if they're done on a lot-by-lot basis, they're not going to be bringing that type of equipment, I wouldn't think, to do that.
Okay.
And finally, the Shade Tree Commission report. Page 2, paragraph 2, again deals with stormwater flows, mentions the driveway on lot 17.02, and that a major portion of that lot is comprised of wetlands and wetlands buffer. And as we stated, that entire area will be incorporated in the conservation easement. That's almost 8 acres of that lot just for that portion of the conservation easement. And as far as the driveway, that too, I think we would work with staff to try and minimize clearing and disturbance within the limits of the lot to position the driveway to avoid trees where possible.
Yeah, at some point, are you going to discuss that extremely long driveway to lot 1702? Is that all going to be detention, and how is it going to be handled?
Well, it would only need to be detention. Enough of it would need to be detention to take care of the impervious surfaces. The driveways themselves are going to be porous pavement. So the entire driveway would have some stone under it. You may not need to have a lot of stone under the entire driveway because it is so long, but certainly a portion of it you may have a couple of feet of stone underneath the driveway, and it may involve also putting some pipes under the driveways to provide additional storage, because you do get more storage when you put in pipes than just stone. But I wouldn't envision that whole thing being a detention basin, but it would all be porous pavement.
And plowable, I take it.
Pardon me?
And can be plowed when it snows?
Sure. Porous pavement, actually, we've had very good success with that. It's plowable. It actually dries out a lot faster than regular pavement, so icing is not as much of a problem as it is with regular pavement.
And it handles salt well?
You can put salt on it. It's not recommended that you sand it, however. And there also are maintenance requirements that will have to be addressed. So as part of the approval, I think you know, that would be something that would have to be dealt with. You are supposed to pressure wash them occasionally and vacuum them to make sure that they continue to drain.
But all of these things, in combination with the fact that the porous pavement allows the stormwater to go through, providing it isn't blocked by sand or so on, is a...
Right. So there would be a maintenance manual for the driveways explaining to the homeowners what it is they need to do to keep the porous pavement in the shape that it needs to be.
It's going to take a lot of work to be a homeowner in some of these houses.
Well, there is some maintenance. It's not really that onerous, I don't think. I think that's pretty much it.
That's our responses to the reports. I don't know if there's any further questions.
Yes, any further board questions?
I have a question about just maintenance issues. So we've got trees in the conservation easement, and we've got detention basins, and there's quite a number of different maintenance issues. Are these all part of the homeowners association, or are they divided up by lot, or how does that work?
The trees are separately. There's no maintenance obligation. It's a natural forest. If the homeowner would like to plant additional trees to supplement, there's nothing prohibiting them. They can't clear them or move away the brush. It's just supposed to be natural forest. That's the intent of that. So there's no maintenance obligation there. What was the other question? The stormwater would be, have we discussed that? It would be a homeowner's responsibility,
it would be each homeowner's individual driveway that they would have to take care of, yes.
Okay.
But there'd be a maintenance manual that applies to all of the lots in the development?
Yeah, and one more point, I'm sorry. The cul-de-sac basin would be maintained by a small homeowner's association of the four lots, and they'll take care of the maintenance obligation.
And would that be part of the deeds?
Yes.
Okay, if there are no more questions, what I'd like to do is open the meeting for public comments and questions and so on. If you could come up, be sworn in, give your name, have about 3-4 minutes to...
Sure. Robert B. Hendler. Robert B. Hendler. I don't live in the preserve.
Well,
I live in the block.
It's our practice whenever anyone's talking to us for us to swear them in to the extent they're providing testimony. So do you swear or affirm testify truthfully to the extent that you're providing testimony?
Yes, I do.
Thank you.
I don't live in the preserve, as I said. I actually live in block 2102, lot 23. That's lot.
Sir, you have to use the microphone because the meeting is being recorded. If you could get one from there, great.
Does it work?
Yeah.
Okay, good. You can see my house is right here. So I'm located right here. There's a swimming pool located on my property around here. And there's a very serious drainage problem. As the engineer said, I think the engineer's quote that it's, I wrote it down, referring to the property as how steep the grade is. There's a steep grade of this property that flows this way. All the water from up here drains down this way. There's a serious drainage problem. This lot owner here also has a pool. On at least two occasions, the pool here has been filled with mud that flows down from here. I have cured the problem somewhat by building a retainage wall, various drainage things, but there's still now water comes down this way. Her pool also, at least on two occasions, was also filled with mud. It had to be pumped out. So there is a serious drainage problem. I don't think the proposal to solve the drainage problem really addresses the drainage problem. Nothing is being really done. The only thing as part of this approval is what they're talking about is a homeowners association to deal with the drainage around this circle. Everything else is left open. If they happen to sell this lot first, this lot's in their driveway will deal with their drainage. It won't be taking into account drainage from other properties that may be developed. And the maintenance of those are now dependent upon that homeowner. If that homeowner doesn't maintain it, then it's not going to be maintained. There's no basis of requiring that homeowner to maintain that drainage facility. So nothing is being done with that drainage problem, and just being left, and it exists, and it's only going to be aggravated by the development of this property. So I think that's a major concern to me with regard to the development, and I don't think it's been addressed. And so I think it has to be on a unified basis in dealing with it, and has to be dealt with by an association, whether it's detention, but certainly so that it can be enforced and not left to a homeowner handling it, when he plows his driveway or he doesn't plow his driveway. I think the other concern that I had, in the plans that I saw with regard to this development, was the change of grade. That there's a proposed major change of grade. I'm not certain what this plan is, but I believe it's over here in front of my property.
We can't see that.
Yeah, we can't see at all what you're doing.
Yeah, sheet 7.
Mark that.
Do we mark that? I don't know if we mark that.
No. I'm not certain what sheet this is.
Sheet 7.
Sheet 7 of 16. Sheet 7 plan. Again, as I pointed out to you, my house is located here, pool here, and you can see on the contours here, this is a major change of the grade that they propose on this property. Now, I'm not certain what you're doing. You propose, you've now added a 40-foot buffer. I guess I should have called you up. Maybe I would have gotten a 100-foot buffer, but you propose a 40-foot buffer, but are you proposing to change the grade within the buffer and remove the trees?
That grading will have to be changed once the buffer is incorporated. That's why we were asking to reduce the side yard so that the house could be pulled away from that line.
So
not changing the grade within 40 feet of your property line.
But you're changing the grade.
We're not changing the grade
But you're changing the grade. You're changing the grade. You're just not changing it as close to my property as shown on this plan. But you're raising the grade here from what it presently is. Can you tell me approximately how many feet is represented by that contour?
Yeah. Is that your plan, sheet 7, or was with the...
Okay. Looks like it's being raised approximately 5 feet, but again, these are conceptual locations and conceptual house designs. I would expect anybody building on that lot is not actually going to grade that lot like that, that they would want to build some walls to make up that grade difference rather than just sloping it off like that. I did just confer a little bit with Jack West. And what we would suggest doing is constructing some type of a berm and swale system along that property line to address Mr. Hendler's concern with the existing drainage condition. So it would be
you're suggesting a swale that would be above those two properties are beginning above?
Yes, it would be along that northerly property boundary adjacent to Mr. Hendler's property and the property to the northeast.
And that would...
That would be outside of the buffer?
Yeah, well, yes, it would be, it would have to be outside of the buffer to preserve the woods.
When you say a swale, what are you, swales, are you talking about like a trench is what you call a swale?
Well, a berm and swale would be a combination of a trench and a hump, basically.
Okay, did you have other questions? Because I don't know whether there are other people who would like to speak also.
I have a few more issues that I had.
Could you go through them
succinctly? I understand. I thought it's quite important to me since I do live there.
Right, but this, it's...
And it seemed to me I felt the board should, or the record should reflect that.
I understand that, and why don't you go succinctly through your other questions?
Okay.
We can hear, and then we'll see if the other people here have the same questions, and we'll get some sort of answers from the applicant.
What I didn't understand was, at least in the report that I saw, that each of the lots had 4 acres plus the larger lot had more than 4 acres. Am I correct?
That's correct.
Well, then I can't understand why extending the cul-de-sac wouldn't reduce the size of those 4 acres lots on either side of around the cul-de-sac to less than 4 acres.
Well, if you look at the sketch below, which was...
We can hardly hear what you're saying.
So you can't hear you.
The microphone really close to your mouth.
Okay, if you look at the sketch below, which shows the conventional layout with the cul-de-sac extended, those lots have been reconfigured slightly, and the area that was added to the cul-de-sac was actually taken out of lots 17.02. So 17.02 became slightly smaller. The other lots retained their 4-acre size.
This is the map showing the extension?
Yes.
And what I didn't quite understand, at least in report...
Excuse me, sir. Could you speak into the microphone, please? We're having difficulty.
Staff report showed that each lot was 4 acres, correct?
That's correct.
And then it seemed to me if you extend this, you are taking away from this lot part of the 4 acres.
That's true, but the lot lines are adjusting. So as you
bring
it in, you adjust all the lots so that they are a minimum of 4 acres.
These lots on this plan have been adjusted?
That is correct.
So this lot and this lot and this lot are 4 acres?
Yes, that's true.
So,
some of you have more time, you can come back to them.
If I could reserve the time to speak after.
Sorry?
You wanted other people to have hear their comments. So
we've got some more time. Let me just ask the applicant, did you have a conversation with this gentleman about any of these problems ahead of time?
Not directly, no. We heard, I think he may have raised some concerns with staff because we sat down with staff to, when they told us some of the things we need to address, and that's why we came up with the current buffering plan and a change. So we're no longer grading to the property line. We're going to have a conservation easement, and now the last element we're adding is some sort of swale, correct me if I'm wrong, to collect any type of drainage that would flow in that direction to keep runoff away and out of the conservation.
Right. It's just a little bit confusing that things are being added to the plan as we speak.
They're good ideas. They're good ideas.
Right. They're good. They may be good ideas, but there's less and less on paper. And I would, you know, we do have another application this evening, and I respect the fact that you have a lot of questions about this. So let me see what some of these other people have to say, and then maybe we can get back to you, if that's all right. Yes, do you want to come up and...
Can you hear me? My name is George Savino. I live at 1201 Stewart Road.
I'm going to ask, to the extent that you're providing testimony, would you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
I do.
Thank you.
Should I repeat all of that or no? Okay. My property is on the southern end of the property in question, and I'm right below the detention basin, and the flow outflow from the detention basin runs right across my property. It's block 6, lot 3701.
Okay.
It's probably not on the large-scale map that you use. It's hard to see. Anyway, not to waste time.
You're going to have to speak up.
Okay. Can you hear me?
That's better.
Okay. The drainage stormwater problems on that site, I've been living there for 34 years, and I'm quite aware of what the problems are. I've discussed this with Mr. West over a couple of meetings that we've had in the last couple of days. As a matter of fact, the township at that time was aware of this problem, and the Department of Public Works has been aware of my problem. Previously to, I have subsequently paved a portion of my driveway. The gravel came to about 2 feet, 3 feet high onto Stewart Road and flowed down into Stewart Country Day School's driveway. The water is such quantity and such velocity and speed that it just carries the gravel all the way across Stewart Road and into Stewart Road, into the Stewart Country Day School. And when they redid Stewart Road paving and put in the curbs, the town was granted to put a catch basin on either side of my driveway at the entrance, which hasn't really appreciably helped. I've spent a lot of money and labor trying to deal with this situation over the past 34 years, and I have it now probably manageable. It's still a problem. The problem as I see it, and I'm an architect, is that this stormwater runoff and the grading of the soil that they use to calculate the capacity of the catch basin, I believe, is based on whether that the road is well not frozen and that it has a permeable surface. If any of you are familiar with Stewart Road, you'll see that the comment of saying spotted boulders is an understatement. I would venture a guess that my property and adjacent properties, along where I am, the boulders and rocks constitute 60 to 70% of the surface. So water, even in the warm weather, doesn't flow very well. But when we have a snap freeze, the ground is frozen, the rocks don't help, and the water has no place to go except down across our neighboring properties. And I think that's a problem. This permeable driveway problem, you mentioned sand. If you can't use salt, how do they plow? How do they deal with the snow buildup? Who's going to do it? I'm confused with the property and how it's owned. Jenny questioned who's going to own these properties. They haven't worked that out. If it's an individual property, a catch basin only will work if it's maintained and the outflow where the water eventually comes out is not clogged with leaves or overgrown grass or whatever it may be. So the water is going to build up. If I'm looking at the drawings, that catch basin, I think if I'm reading them correctly, is about 2 feet deep and it's relatively small. And that's a lot of water, I believe, that's going to be coming off the ground that's changing its natural state. And if the permeable driveway doesn't function, it's additional water that's going to come, and that catch basin is going to overflow. Now, I was told that the catch basin was calculated on the basis of a classification of D, which is the lowest that they have. My question to the engineer is that D grade based on when the ground is frozen and it's 60 or 70% rocks and boulders, or is it soil where water can permeate? What I'm looking at, and I've lived with for 34 years, I have had streams running down my driveway 10 feet wide and 2 feet high and hides all of the boulders off the sides of my driveway. Now, that's not dribbled water. That's a stream. And I'm very concerned that my property and all the money that I've invested to get to a manageable situation is going to be destroyed if that all that water's coming out of that catch basin right across my property.
Okay.
And that's basically my problem or my concern.
Okay. I think that's probably, I think you expressed the problems. You've talked to staff about this already, yes. I take.
Yes, we have.
And have you talked to the applicant? No? Just to staff?
Jack and I have had a couple of conversations already.
So.
Basically what happens, is, and I've talked to several of the neighbors about, obviously drainage is a big concern, and as have you heard from both residents, currently they're having a problem with stormwater runoff. So what we look at is how can we minimize that? We can't make it go away. They're developing their property, but we look at how can we minimize that, and that's what's happening with this application. They're required to reduce the amount of runoff that's going onto those properties from, you know, prior to development to after development. And that's how they do with the detention basin, with the poorest driveways. Obviously, maintenance is a concern with any development, whether it's through a homeowners association, a commercial property. Maintenance is always a problem. There's a maintenance manual that has to be submitted with the application, and the town monitors that. If there's a problem, we get a complaint, we do the inspection. It's not a fail-safe system, but there are mechanisms that these systems do have to be maintained. So we're comfortable that there's less runoff from this site after development than there is currently. After meeting with the neighbors, you know, we looked at ways, how can we minimize it? We talked about on the northerly side of the property, trying to do kind of a combination swale and berm. And the reason it's a combination swale and berm, to do a proper swale, you'd have to take down more trees. So we don't want to do that. So we look at ways to minimize the impact on the trees, but we think we can channel a lot of the water away from the adjacent houses. And that's what we'll look at when we look at the individual plot plans for each of these lots.
Can I ask a question of the engineers in terms of just classification D, which is forming the basis of the size and the capacity of the detention basin?
What he's referring to is soil type D. There's four types of soils, A, B, C, and D. A type A soil is a sandy soil that the water perks through. Type D, the water doesn't perk through very well. In Princeton, you have type D soils. So that's what this system is designed on. It's not designed if the ground were frozen, but it is designed taking into consideration the boulders and the poor soil types.
The condition, which is I mentioned, where it's really a problem is during the winter months when the ground is frozen, and there's no place for the water to go but on the surface, and it's going to come in not drips and drabs through the detention basin.
Okay, I think.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's see. I guess this man is next. Did you have a question?
I had a question for Mr. West before we go to the next one. Did I understand you correctly to say you feel comfortable that there will be less water runoff after this development than there is now?
That's correct.
Thank you.
Okay. And I'm going to ask, please try to keep your remarks to about 4 minutes, please.
Absolutely. My name is Peter Brav. I live at 176 Highland Terrace, and I'm one of three homeowners in the preserve here tonight. And I'll try and keep it short because they'd like to speak as well.
And to the extent you're providing testimony, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
I do.
Thank you.
I am a former president of the Preserve Homeowners Association. I've lived in the area for 20 years. I am not one of the lots that adjoin the affected area, but it's safe to say that I know a good deal about the history, and I'm not going to get into it because it would take too long tonight. We were in litigation with the prior owner from 2006 until quite recently. It would be an understatement for me to sit here as a homeowner to say that I am quite enthusiastic about this application. What was said tonight by Christopher about the development group. One of the principals does own a lot in the preserve, and he is in the area, and I do believe that they are very, very concerned about maintaining the quality of the area. And we are coming from a situation where we had 9 years of litigation, state court litigation, enormous expense, enormous neighborhood trauma. And I can tell you that this is the best news we've heard. They are receptive to our input. We met two nights ago, and the buffer that you see as the 100-foot was created. And I'm not speaking to any of the drainage concerns or the other concerns that have been raised here, but just from our point of view, as 25 lots, once again, I'm the former president, former board member, but as an individual intimately aware of the situation, I cannot be more enthusiastic. One of the adjoining homeowners is going to speak, and a current member of the board would also like to speak.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, I'm Elliot Gursky. I live with my wife at 2 Oak Ridge Court in the preserve.
Dr. Gursky, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
I do.
Thank you.
Our lot abuts the proposed development. We look at those woods every day. And we've certainly had much concern about what would happen there. We believe that the current proposal has been very thoughtfully done and does the most to preserve the current environment, and we're very pleased and very supportive of the plan as proposed. Thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead.
I wanted to add, in the context of comments made earlier about this plan being a variance because a different plan might have a 6-lot cluster. In 1979, I believe this board approved, I think, a 10-lot cluster. There was no white oak. There was no preserve. It was all woods. And for reasons that it would take too long to get into and are featured in our litigation, that never happened. So when I say that we're enthusiastic, it's because I believe, like Elliot just said, we're going from a 9 or 10-unit cluster to a 6-unit cluster with small homes in a luxury area to a 4-lot subdivision. We're very enthusiastic.
Good evening. My name is Ashish Kumar. I live at 187 Highland Terrace. I swear to tell the truth.
Thank you.
I am a member of the board of the Homeowners Association of the Preserve, and I'd like to express our enthusiastic support for this proposal for all the reasons that my colleagues have and my neighbors have just said, so I won't get into that. I just want to be on the record as saying, as the board, we support this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ed DeFilia. I am the Municipal Policy Specialist for the Stony Brook Millstone Watershed Association. I also swear to tell the truth. We have some concerns about drink.
I think we're hearing you. Do you want
to? Sure. So it's Edward DeFilia. That's D-I, capital F-I-G-L-I-A.
And your title?
Municipal Policy Specialist.
Millstone.
Okay. Good. I just wanted to come back to a comment back to the engineering and zoning report in section 4, subsection E, that first part where we're talking about the drainage issues relating to it not being a major development, that because a lot of the discussion tonight has been revolving around the fact that these lots could potentially be sold off and developed piecemeal, this comment was suggesting that it could be required that the lots be conforming under the major site development for the drainage, and I was just curious if that had been addressed in your conversations that you'd had.
Yes, each individual lot will be considered a major development.
Okay.
They'll have to meet the major development stormwater standards.
Okay, that was our concern, and it's addressed. Thank you.
My name is Rajiv Malhotra. I live on 53 White Oak Drive. I'll just point it out, it's right there.
And I'm going to ask, to the extent you're providing testimony, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully?
Yes, I do.
Thank you.
Myself and the gentleman who owned the house across the street, also on White Oak Drive, also adjacent to the land, are the two who went and bought this from foreclosure. The primary purpose I have is to make sure my neighborhood is okay, because I've lived there for 20 years in this house and intend to live there for the rest of my life. So when we looked at what the options are, the main option, the first priority was to get rid of this prior development proposal to make some commercial thing or 10 lots or 10 or whatever number of lots and do something which would be good for the neighborhood, upgrade the neighborhood, preserve the character of the area. So I just wanted to express that is the intention with which we've done this, because we're living there right next to it ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Anyone else? I promised the gentleman who spoke first that he could finish his questions. We need a couple more.
Well, I just want to reemphasize the importance of the drainage issue, that it not be left individual to maintain this or the swale. I'm not certain if you're referring to a berm. Are you talking about a swale with a berm?
Yeah, well, we're having trouble hearing you again.
Are you referring to a swale with a berm on the inside? Which side would have a berm? On your side of the property?
Well, the entire thing would be located on our property. The berm would be downstream of the swale and prevent the water from going over onto your property.
Okay. And it just seemed to me that swale, as well as the proposed drainage issue, should be maintained by a homeowners association. Certainly the members that just spoke are all members of a homeowners associations, which I certain protected the rights of that particular community, the same as a homeowners association will take care and maintain the drainage issues here, not just the drainage issues around the circle that they propose to have a homeowners association, but that same homeowners association should maintain all of the drainage on the property and have the responsibility of maintaining it and collect the funds from the homeowner so they have adequate funds to maintain it.
Okay, thank you very much. Anyone else? Okay, hearing none, let me close the public portion of the meeting. Would you care to comment on the last issue?
I heard a lot of comments raised in...
What about having a homeowners association maintain the...
I think I need to talk to my clients about that, because it's a little unique. Here you have an individual driveway, a person's access, and it's just a little odd. If it was a separate facility, not part of the elements of the house, it's a little unique, so I don't want to just jump on and say okay, because it's out of the ordinary. Because let me just take a step back. We could certainly put detention. I'm going to take one more step back. We will meet code requirements, so we are going to reduce runoff, period. Okay? So the question is, how do we do that? And we can do that by putting in place traditional elements like detention basins. And maybe, you know, your professionals think in some situations it may be better. We're suggesting, because we want to minimize disturbance, we are actually taking a more expensive approach by saying we're going to try to the best that we can put it underneath these disturbed areas. So we want to bring elements like impervious pavement, we want to put it under patios, we want to collect the water under there, and we think we can do it. So that's how we got here. We don't have to go down that route, but...
Yeah. I think the board has heard that, and they're appreciative of that approach. They're now worried about maintenance, and the question, and maybe you could take a moment to talk to your clients whether we talk about maintenance through the homeowners association.
Alan, if you did that, you would need easements on each lot.
Homeowners association documents that the homeowners have access for maintenance purposes. With the backup that if they don't maintain it, that comes back as a municipal obligation with to be supported by tax liens.
Part of a manual, isn't it? Bylaws, so I have to include these. Well, if you've got a long ditch running along there, somebody's got to clean it out. Mildred's going to do it.
Besides,
I live next to it.
Oh, I see.
I really do.
Yeah. So do you have tea for your...
No.
Association.
I'm not sure if I completely understood, but if the question is the homeowners association who's going to be responsible for the detention facility that maintains the cul-de-sac, if we would also include the northern swale in terms of the maintenance obligation, we could agree to that.
Okay. Are there any other items? Did you want
to? I missed the last part of your statement. The swale, the berm and the swale.
The berm, swale, whatever elements are up there, the berm and swale, I guess, is how we're describing it, as well as the detention facilities for the cul-de-sac.
But not the detention facilities for the individual lots?
We think that the homeowners would do that, and then if they don't, the municipality has the ability to enforce against them.
Okay. Well, I guess that becomes a planning board issue as part of the approval that we can talk about.
And like I said, our only hesitancy there is that you're talking about elements of an individual's house, their patio. You know, that's why I kind of... You typically, when you have a homeowners association, they're outside elements, not within a unit. That type of, and it gets a little messy.
But it, I guess what the board has heard is that, although that's a good addition, maintenance becomes extremely important, and if it falls and is ignored, it impacts the whole area.
All right. Any other questions? Did you want to sum up, or do you feel?
Yeah. I think this is a really nice a really nice approach to this particular area. It's clearly underdeveloped. It's clearly something that has a lot of input from the neighbors. I tried to take you through the process because a lot of times you see the more intense development plan, and here we came in with, you know, our best case, what we can really do and what we think is great for the neighborhood. The variances, again, would be the setback variance to allow us to create that northern berm and conservation area, and also the frontage requirement, which, again, all these variances are technical because we could remove them by adjusting the lot, but creating a larger cul-de-sac doesn't make any sense. So thank you very much for the opportunity to present this case for you this evening.
Okay. Yes, Mildred?
Before we leave this portion, could you just explain to me again exactly what the Homeowners Association would be responsible for? What are the responsibilities of
okay.
the homeowner?
So the project includes the expansion of the White Oak Drive and the creation of a cul-de-sac. That cul-de-sac drains to a basin area, which is going to be a small basin, which is going to be, we think, located, where is it? Right here, this little square on the map. Okay? The Homeowners Association will be responsible for maintaining that basin. We've also, through the testimony this evening, agreed to add a berm and swale on the northern section of 1702 near the edge of the conservation area that we're proposing. And they will also have the ability and responsibility to maintain that swale so that it's functioning correctly.
Is it anticipated that some of the runoff from the higher gradation will go into that storm drain?
Well, the property
that you're building at in that little corner.
Yeah. So the property is unique in that runoff goes in at least three different directions. And if you like, I could show the engineer can show you just the general slope.
Right. This is sort of the top of the hill. The height where White Oak actually ends up being right at the property. And this portion, the southerly half, flows pretty much southerly. But then the contours turn and the water flows westerly and even in a portion a little bit northwesterly. So it really flows almost radially from the cul-de-sac.
So where would the flow be going into the swale that we have agreed to look into, the berm and swale?
Well, that drainage is moving pretty much westerly, maybe a little bit northwesterly, so that berm and swale would direct it so that we go further down, bypassing Mr. Hendler's house, and would drain into the wetlands there.
Jeff, how far is that swale going to the east?
I think we'd have to work that out with Jack. It probably would have to be on lot 1701 as well as 1702.
Okay, yeah, so you said 1702. I thought it had to be on 1701 also.
Yeah, we're looking to probably run most of the length of 1701 and then on 1702 get past where the proposed house will be and then direct that water into the wetland area.
Thank you.
Anyone else? All right, if there are no more questions, and Mr. Porter has taken incredible notes on this.
Oh, well, I have a comment.
Yeah, I have a really basic question.
Yes.
Which is, what's the purview of the board here? So right now there's three properties, and there's obviously variances required to make it four properties with this application, but is there a way to do it basically as a right? If they extend the cul-de-sac, is that then as a right where they could do four and they're not asking for any variances, so we can't say, I mean, I think the Environmental Commission recommendation here is that it would be a lot better to have three properties in terms of the amount of disturbance. And I completely understand where the Homeowners Association from the Preserve, when they were here a decade ago or two decades ago, and we're looking at 10 properties, and then you get it down to four, that seems like a victory. But there's been a sea change here on the planning board since you've been away, where I think we look at the ridge completely differently, and we're very wary of putting a lot of development up there because of all the issues that have been raised with stormwater and with the environment up there and the sensitivity. So I want to just get a sense of what our options are.
I guess your question is, if we deny the application because we deny the variance, could the applicant could come back with a complying application for four lots without a variance?
Or I thought six.
Or more under a cluster, but let's stay with the four for the moment. The answer is if we don't have a variance, then there's no variance power, and it would be a conforming application, which we would not have the power to deny.
You mean for four?
For four.
Even though right now it's three lots?
But yeah, they're consolidating those. So from our point of view, they could turn it into one lot and come in. So what the how the lines fall now is not particularly relevant. If they could just through a deed of consolidation create one lot and come in with three or four. So I think the pre-existing three is not a significant factual component of this.
Okay, and then another concern I had was, I think it was sheet number 7, and the changing of the grade. And it looked like each of the new homes was going to be built on top of a new hill. And I understand why you'd want to do that if there's issues with stormwater. But it does concern me about the impact to the neighbors and also the neighborhood character when you're building the homes up like that. And I don't know if the board has any ability to put some restriction on that.
Well, I think the board's the one element that the board does retain through the engineering department is the ability through this application to require, in effect, site plan approval for each of the individual lots, which would then look at the try to minimize the amount of tree disturbance, the grading issues, the drainage issues, and all of those would require an engineered site plan before a building permit could issue, and would take into account the sensitive issues that we've identified in terms of grading, drainage, tree removal, impervious coverage.
I think Jack wanted to say something.
Right. And Jack?
Yeah, one of them. Our comment early on the report where we said they didn't meet, matching, tying into the environment, that's really because of the way it was graded. Now, granted, this is just shown conceptually. Doesn't mean, obviously that the lot with the long driveway that's got a ski slope for the backyard, that it's not going to be developed that way. And the reason it looks like they're mounded up is because you have a sloping site and they're trying to put a level house, so you kind of cut on one side, fill on the other. That's why there's so much grading shown on this plan. These are going to be custom homes, and when we review each individual plot plan, we look to minimize that disturbance and tie it in to the natural surroundings a lot better. This is just shown to see that yes, you can develop these properties and grade them off.
Okay. Anybody else?
I just wanted to talk about the trees again and the caliper. I mean, I'd like to require the 3.5-inch or above caliper.
These were the trees around the cul-de-sac.
For the replanting, number 4.3 on the the staff comments? Or no?
It's number, it's 4.3 under additional comments.
Right.
Yeah, it's the trees around the cul-de-sac. Right.
That's acceptable to applicant.
Anything else, anyone? You want to try the? There's an awful lot of stuff.
Just let us. Yeah, it's basically there are the staff reports which the applicant basically agrees with. They the plans will be modified to show the conservation easement as shown on exhibit, which exhibit, is that A3? And so the plans will be redrawn to show that. They'll also show the berm and swell along the northerly side of Lot 17.01. There would be a required maintenance manual for the individual that would apply both to the detention basin that will serve the cul-de-sac as well as the maintenance of what will ultimately be the stormwater management facilities on each of the individual lots. There driveways will be of porous pavement with drainage through a engineered basis subject to the approval of our engineering staff as well as our stormwater consultant if needed. The grading is really not part of this application. That will be part of the individual lot approval, which will take into account grading, rock location to minimize blasting, reducing the amount of runoff, dealing with the site location issues for the proposed developments. I think although Mr. DeGrazia talked about deer fencing in the conservation easement area, I think we agreed that it should not be there, and that would not be permitted in the conservation area. If there is fencing, it would be around the house or around on the rest of the lot to protect the landscaping. And then we've talked about requiring the swale and berm area to be maintained by the Homeowners Association as well as maintenance of the detention basin. An open issue at this point is still whether maintenance of the individual drainage facilities or the facilities on the individual lots would be required to be done on a coordinated basis through the Homeowners Association. That, I think that's an issue that may take a vote in further discussion.
Should we do that right now? Because I support the idea of the Homeowners Association being responsible for the drainage as you were talking about.
So,
is there a consensus that should be in the resolution?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so that would be part of the motion.
When we talked about the trees, did we talk about the substitution of white oaks for red oaks?
If they didn't talk about it, it was agreed.
Okay. Anything else? Anyone?
Yeah, I think there's going to be a lot of required discussion between the applicant and staff in going from here to there. So these issues should be worked out, some of the drainage issues and maintenance issues, so that we have a comprehensive approach.
Yes, and will the staff also take care of boulder issues so that we don't?
Jack's got his sledgehammer ready.
I'm ready for the boulders.
Okay, just because it always
you know, a blasting plan, if there is to be blasting, will be required. A hauling plan.
Okay. Any other points? Anyone? Down there? Anything else? All right, now that let's have the person with the best memory recite all that as a motion.
I have the perfect way to do it.
All right, go ahead.
I move approval of this application conditioned upon each of the items articulated by Mr. Porter.
And as included in the staff reports. And
as included in the staff report, et cetera, et cetera.
Thank you.
And is what I mean.
And again, the variances are the frontage variances as well as the 60, the one to move down and the 20 feet and the 60 feet.
Derek, is that correct? The variances? Okay. Right. Is there a second for that? Anyone?
Julie Capizzoli, I'll second that motion.
Okay, second by Ms. Capizzoli. All right, do you want to call the roll on that one, please?
Ms. Capizzoli?
Yes.
Ms. Krummiller?
Yes.
Mayor Lempert?
Yes.
Ms. Spruill?
Yes.
Mrs. Trotman?
Yes.
Mr. Quinn?
Yes.
Mr. Williamson?
Yes.
Mrs. Gunning?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you very much. I missed the part with the homeowner association. Can you just clarify, is it all right to have the homeowner primarily responsible and then the homeowners association responsible also if the homeowner doesn't maintain it? Because that's how we would like to set it up in the documents. And it gives you the ability to go after both because they both would be responsible.
So let's say that issue will be the subject of
contract
conditions that reflect the sense of what we talked about, with the detail to be worked out with between the staff, the council, and the applicant.
Okay, I appreciate that.
The main idea being that there's a backup that involves the homeowners collecting fees and being responsible.
Thank you. Appreciate your time this evening. Sorry it took so long. Have a nice night.
Okay. There is a second application. I just wanted to say that I will be recusing myself from this one because it's a university property. My husband is an employee of the university. Do you want a break before you do it?
No. Okay. Go for it.
You may do it.
I'm accusing myself as well.
Oh, that's right.
This is Ms. Paul. And I will be accusing myself also.
Get together. Call me one time.
Do you have a card?
Get together. Is this the way we have to do it? This is what I do. Firm, where are you going? Oh, you have to recuse yourself? Oh, okay. 4, 5. Oh, okay.
Do we have enough? So, since this is really a no-brainer,
we still have an application. It's going to be quick, but we got to do it.
Can we just do the benefit? He's going to make a record.
We've done the hard work. This is easy.
You do have a quorum, don't you? You do have a quorum, don't you?
This is an application.
this is an application from T-Mobile Northeast LLC. This is a minor site plan with conditional use. And Mr. Solo, I guess you will walk us through this memo and...
But can I, just for this side of the dais, we've been talking, and this really does seem like a no-brainer, so if we can do it as fast as possible, we'll all be happy.
Our due diligence will be given.
Good evening.
Mr. Solo, do you swear or affirm to testify truthfully in this application?
I do, and quickly. I've put up a composite of the drawings that you have. To the left on this board is sheet Z2. In the middle is sheet Z3. And to the right is also part of sheet Z3. I'll label that as PB1. As you all know, this is a minor site plan and conditional use application. It's for property that is owned by Princeton University. The lot itself is a little over 140 acres in size. However, the application is limited to a small portion of the graduate college. Just to orient you briefly, Mercer Street up here to the far left, Springdale Road, College Road in the middle, which is how you provide access to the graduate school. The red circle shows you the steeple, which is also shown on the right side of the board, where the antennas will be located. Currently, T-Mobile has three antennas and associated equipment located in the steeple. The antennas are at a height, a center line height, of approximately 140 feet. The applicant is seeking approval for three existing antennas and additional equipment, all to be located in this area of the graduate college. The antennas are what we consider a stealth site. They can't be seen. If you've been out to the site, as we were, you really have to look to see anything. So they're very difficult to see. The property is located in the E2 zone. Wireless telecommunication facilities are permitted conditional uses in that zone. The applicant has provided reports that document compliance with our conditional use standards, and I'm sure they can summarize their testimony. I don't know if there are any questions from the board for me, or again, Mr. West and Mr. Bridger are here as well.
If I have to break a record there. Questions? Then could we hear from the applicant, please?
Sure. Good evening, everyone. My name is Eric Goldberg. I'm the attorney for the applicant from the law firm of Stark & Stark. I know the board is looking for a 2.5-hour presentation. What I will do is I will sum this up in about 1 minute, then I'll ask all the witnesses to come down, and they will just basically corroborate that everything that myself, Mr. Solo, have said is accurate, and that would be the testimony, which...
Okay, so in that case, or even if that were not the case, we're going to ask if you swear or affirm to testify truthfully as you summarize your witness's testimony?
I absolutely will, absolutely. We agree with certainly everything that Mr. Solo said. It's... Basically, you cannot see it. Even looking for it, you cannot see it. The purpose of this site is to provide coverage. There's currently a significant coverage gap along the Princeton campus, and that's what this site will cover, as well as portions of Alexander Street, the Springdale Golf Course, and Springdale Road. This site will provide also no noise, odor, glare, dust, or pollution. As previously noted, at least three of the antennas have been existing for many, many years, and probably nobody even noticed that they were even there until this application.
I might add, they've not been approved as to the existing ones.
Correct. How they got there, we don't know, but that's been the situation. So what the applicant is looking for is conditional use approval for all six of the antennas, as well as site plan approval. As previously mentioned, also the base station and equipment will be inside and will not be visible to the public. If everybody could just kind of stand up.
My name is Rafi Ashiba. I'm the RF engineer for RAFFI. Last name is ACHIB as in boy A.
And Rafi, you're an expert radio frequency engineer?
That is correct.
And the board, I would ask the board accept such.
We accept credentials.
Okay. Thanks.
Pete?
My name is Petros. Last name is Choukalas, TSOUKALAS. Professional engineer in the state of New Jersey, work for Mazer Consulting.
And professional engineer, licensed and accepted as such, I presume?
Wait, your credentials.
My name is Kenneth R. Foster, F-O-S-T-E-R. I'm an expert on radio frequency health and safety and compliance with federal exposure limits. I'm a registered professional engineer in Pennsylvania.
And he'd be
accept
offered
your
such.
Credentials.
And also just one other thing to add, the site complies with all applicable electromagnetic frequency transmissions for both state and federal. Dr. Foster, did you hear the offer proof that I gave as well as the statements made by Mr. Sullivan? Do you agree with all those statements?
Yes.
Pete, did you hear the offer proof that was given by myself as well as the summation by Mr. Sullivan? Do you agree with all the statements?
I do.
Rafi, did you hear the offer proof that was given by myself as well as Mr. Sullivan? Do you agree with all the statements?
Yes, I do.
I'm not
sure. I swear them all in, so to the extent you just gave testimony, it was truthful. Thank you.
That is it. Unless you're looking for more, in which case we have plenty of witnesses more.
Have you gotten the... I'm just curious how three antennas get up there with, and they haven't been approved by anyone, apparently. You said that they've been there for several years now?
That we believe, yeah, I mean, unfortunately...
So no one knows how they got there?
Honestly, no. I mean, unfortunately, everybody is new to this and how what happened years ago, exactly when they got there, I don't know anybody.
Now, we looked extensively through the records, and I must say if anyone is very vigilant about getting permits, it's the university, so I don't know if it... We're not sure what happened.
Fair enough. Just
there was something getting approval from the state historic organization.
To extend whatever is needed, certainly, obviously, we'll have to get any other ancillary approvals.
That's
oh,
been
for
received.
The state historic. I just want to state that as we've reviewed a lot of these DAS node sites, and we're always asking that these stealth sites be used. So as far as I can know from historic preservation, we're very enthusiastic about this kind of installation.
The historic New Jersey Historic Preservation Office under 106, is there an approval from them, or has someone applied for it? I guess the staff says that somebody's indicated it will be sent in for approval. Says Dana Freshorn of Acer would do that.
And that came right out of their application. They had indicated that they were going to apply.
So has that been done?
And Tim, if you could identify yourself and have be sworn,
sure.
Please.
Hi, Tim Johnson, SmartLink, LLC. We are meeting with SHPO.
You have to be sworn in.
You swear affirm to testify truthfully.
I do.
Yep.
We're actually meeting with the SHPO office on Monday out at Princeton University. It'll be me, I think Rafi, and...
The question is, you will obtain that?
Yeah, we're going to...
The status is you have an appointment
yep,
set up.
Yep, we have an appointment,
week.
Correct. Right.
Thank you.
That's it? All right.
You're good. Questions? Okay, are we ready for a motion? I'm sorry, we're not that fast. If there is anyone in the audience who would like to speak to this issue, would you please come forward? Seeing no one, I will close the public hearing. Now, are we ready for a motion?
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
I'll second, Julie Capizzoli.
The motion carries. Madam Clerk, would you please call the roll?
Ms. Capizzoli?
Yes.
Ms. Krummiller?
Yes.
I'm losing space. Mrs. Trotman?
Yes.
Mr. Quinn?
Yes.
Did I get everybody? Mr. Williamson.
Yeah, I knew it was member. Yes.
Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
You're welcome. Any more business?
All go that easy.
Motion to adjourn.
Someone adjourn?
I just did.
Oh.
Is there
a... I'll second.
She adjourned?
She moved to adjourn.
Seconded.
I just seconded.
Okay. Meeting adjourned.
Aye.
How long did that take? Oh, 5 minutes?
Yeah. fastest application
kind of business,
on
my record.